Whitlock, and I have my new microphone that I saved up for by not using my per diem that I receive from Scotland every time I do a report, or every day. This is my new microphone, and it says here on it, it's a monster high. So that must be, this is probably a very prestigious brand, Monster High. And look, it has a cord, a real long cord. I can't get it. Okay, it's still going. It's a cord. It goes all the way down. And that I can use the cord caddy for. The cord caddy.
From a magazine, been looking for the answers ever since we were 17. You know the truth can be a weapon to fight this world of ill intentions. New answer to the same question, how many times will you learn the same lesson?
This week's headlines: sit in your arse, Kylie Jenner said so, and behave yourself. And welcome to CNT News. My name is Cammy Sutra, and today is Tuesday, the 27th of February. In a week where Donald Trump comes under fire for his use of cue cards. Cue cards which he used to remind himself to listen, to nod when spoken to, and to blink for 4-second intervals. I mean, cue cards. I mean, what kind of idiot needs cue cards? A week where fast food giant McDonald's see a surge in sales due to competitor KFC running out of chicken. When questioned, the fast food giant weighed the blame with the delivery company. Absolutely nothing to do with Colonel Sanders now being a woman. And a week that highlights that it's not necessarily a good idea for women to tell other women what to wear. Whether that's yoga pants in the gym or Versace dresses in the cold, one thing is for sure, feminists complain about fucking everything. In a week like this, you need a news source that you can rely on. A news source that puts you at the centre of the story. And we at CNT, together with you, we aim to make fake news great again. Now, as weather alerts are spread across the UK to warn of the incoming heavy snow, gentlemen, it's time to grab your long shirts, your heavy jacket, and your shorts. And we don't mean fleece shorts, no. Forget the onesies. It's got to that time of the year where misguided men like to don their winter shorts. Apparently, real men don't cover those pasty legs when the cold snap hits. Yes, where others reach for pants, or as they're called in England, trousers, or as it's called in Scotland, leg hair. Yes, real men take the same approach as fat women in the summer, and they reach for the shorts. But why? Let's ask Wendy Applebottom.
Thank you, Cammy. That's right. Today I'm called to talk about men who wear shorts in winter. Now, I thought I was alone in my disgust of this practice, but as you know, I love to take to Twitter, and I found that there are many, many women and some men who are disgusted with this practice. Now, it seems the worst offenders are straight, white, middle-aged men, and they're often seen wearing cargo shorts. Now, are these men hot? In the sense that they don't feel the cold? Or are they jealous of us women who can wear miniskirts in the winter? Or are they jealous of the Scottish men who get to wear kilts? Now, I thought that this was just an American problem, but it turns out it's a worldwide phenomenon. So I went to Google and I searched hot Scottish men in kilts. I didn't find men who were hot. I found men who were hot. Other than finding that many have a disdain for this, I'm unable to find a reason why this phenomenon exists. So, let this report just be a PSA. Just don't do it. Meteorologist Wendy Applebottom, back to you, Cammie.
Wendy, thank you. Wendy Applebottom reporting there. Fantastic to see some kilts on display there. Do you know why it's called a kilt? Because the last person that called it a skirt got kilted. Now, I feel it's about time that we caught up with Sharon Breaknews, who this week is in Colombia. Not the university, the country, Colombia. And she's back there again. This time, apparently someone is making it rain. And when we say making it rain, we don't mean in the Pablo Escobar sense. Pablo, who used to spend $2,500 per month on rubber bands just to bundle his money together. Now, the country has moved on somewhat since then, with the president of Colombia stating, if you do something for 40 years and it doesn't work, it's time to try a different approach. No, we mean making it rain in the climate change sense. For more on this story, let's pass to Sharon Breaknews.
Yes, that's right, Cammie. Sharon Breaknews here, reporting from the Salinas Valley back in Colombia, where we've received reports of stormy weather that has taken out the entire production of a cannabis in the valley. Now, as you know, this valley is well known for its cannabis production, and this very hazardous weather has caused all sorts of disruptions, and we're here to report on that.
Oh, Mike, look at this. This is awful. Look at the destruction the storm did.
Who would have thought we'd be back in Bogota? Oh. Okay, not Bogota, Salinas Valley, close enough. Bloody hell, we're doing this weather report. There's that dog again. Mike, I know it's not, the weather's just not looking too stormy. It's not gonna be real. Yeah, I know, it's a bit of fake news, but we're gonna add some elements. I need your help.
Use the fan, blow the fan on my face, like in my face, and it, oh. We've got to find a power outlet, like, just kind of, you know, maybe use the hose, put the hose on me, like, hang on, we'll get a good stream, like, ooh, hang on, like this, oh shit, come on, that's it, that looks like rain, oh, okay, that'll do, now, if I stand underneath it, hey, it's raining, quickly, Mike, let's do this. It's raining now. Okay.
Sharon Breakney's here, nothing to report.
Shaza, thank you. Sharon Breakney's reporting there. Back in Colombia. That woman is in Colombia more than Shakira Shakira. And now, our next report this evening focuses on a belief held by many that sitting is the new smoking. We are, of course, referring to the growing trend amongst office workers to ditch their seats and opt for a standing desk. Yes, a standing desk, the perfect accompaniment to that arsehole at your work who makes 37 calls a day and feels the need to stand up and tell everyone. And of course, it is perfect for the lazy worker who wants to give the impression that they are busy. Speaking of which, let's pass over to young Barnaby Frickleton.
Thank you, Camwell. I'm Barnaby Frickleton, Channel 7 CNT News, here with a new medical report. A new study recently published in the Journal of Ergonomics has brought to light a disturbing pandemic.
Ah, Griffin, there you are. I've decided that as your new boss, I'm going to require you to have a standing desk.
But I look like such an ass.
And that's not all. You got to constantly tell everybody what a good idea it is, and how important it is, and how wrong they are for having traditional desks.
Can't I just work at it and mind my own business?
No, you have to be a freak about it.
Maybe it can just be my own personal choice, and I'm not judging others for their choices.
No, you being right means everyone else is wrong. That's what your standing desk is saying to the chair people. From now on, you call them chair people. Oh, and three times a day you have to say, sitting is the biggest killer in America.
Standing desks, that piece of office furniture coveted by CrossFitters and Pelotonians alike, is actually doing more harm than good. It seems that this desperately desired piece of office equipment is actually decreasing cognitive abilities and increasing pain. Cammie, this new information has thrilled seated office workers, hoping that the dulling of the cognitive senses will keep these health nuts from discussing their newest diet or their newest workout regimen. One local office worker who wished to remain anonymous is very grateful that Janice in accounting may now have to be subjected to the pain that she's brought so many others when talking about her cleanse. This office worker went one step further, saying, hopefully Janice will now get to understand what a conversation is like when it feels like a searing ice pick has been inserted into one's ear. There you have it, Cammie. Standing desks, bringing pain and decreased mental functioning to the most annoying in the office. I'm Barnaby Frickleton, CNT News.
Barnaby, thank you. Barnaby Frickleton reporting there. The next time Barnaby asks for a raise, I think I'll get him a standing desk. Speaking of which, it's time for me to stand up from this desk. We'll be back after these with the news.
I was just reading the Book of Income. It's an easy way to make extra income every month. Check it out.
Thanks.
What's this shit? And we're back. Apologies, ladies and gentlemen. I hope no offence was caused there. Somebody put water on my desk. Anyway, Facebook. You know, Facebook, the social platform for olds, for parents, for stalkers, for workers. Yes, Facebook. Facebook has been making the news in the past few weeks as it is making changes to its algorithm. And many marketers are not very happy about this. Mainly because they will now have to do social media as opposed to irritating at scale. And there was me thinking my friends had grown up, whereas it's just the algorithm that has probably weeded out all of those nonsense Valentine's posts. Algorithm. It's a word used by programmers when they don't want to explain what it is they've just done. For more on this story, let's pass to Trent Stone.
Thanks, Cammy. The internet. Not since the birth of religion has there been something so hell-bent on controlling our emotions, thoughts, and opinions. The question is who or what is to blame for the internet's devious plot to control our thoughts and minds. It's called an algorithm. That's right. From Facebook to Google to Candy Crush, algorithms tell us what to read, what we like, and what porn to watch next. And we have no one to blame for the algorithm more than Al Gore himself. Yes, the inconvenient truth is that after inventing the internet, becoming Vice President of the United States, and then losing the presidential election because of a hanging chad, Al Gore turned his attention to programming our minds.
During my service in the United States Congress, I took the initiative in creating the internet.
And if you look closely at the data over the last 20 years, you'll see that algorithms are responsible for populating things that we can't explain. Planking, Angry Birds, Logan Paul, selfies, lip syncing, Logan Paul, influencers, Taco Bell, Canada, beards, Casey Vaynerchuk, Russian hacking, hashtag first world problems, yoga pants, I mean yoga pants, and smoothies. When asked for a comment, Al Gore had this to say.
You are hearing me talk.
No matter where algorithms end up, fact is, it's one of the reasons why you're seeing my face right now. Trent Stone, CNT News.
Trent, thank you. Trent Stone reporting there. A man who knows how to keep a good rhythm. Now, our next story tonight focuses on a young cute girl who wanted to grow up and be as fake and plastic as all of the other bullshit celebrities out there. A young woman who reports suggest can stop a protest march with the flutter of her eyelashes and a sip of some Pepsi. A woman so egotistical, she not only arranged for a plastic surgery consultation for her unborn child, but now that the child has arrived, she has tried to trademark young Stormy's name. Trademark her name. Who does she think she is? Ginny Cunt Breathe? Stormy. What a strange name. Always name your child after the porn star your father masturbates to. But if suggested reports are to be believed, Kylie may well have cost Snapchat $1 billion this week through denouncing the app. Makes you think what other stupidity comes out of this woman's lips. For a story like this, you know who we're turning to. Crystal Waters.
I know, but what are we going to do? I mean, whatever she says goes. She's like the oracle. I'm not doing much. I'm just getting out some of this organic white cheddar gluten-free pasta. Oh my god, Kylie said organic gluten-free cheddar pasta is out. I know, I read that article. I mean, Kylie said it was 22 ways to make your lips look fuller and more natural. Now she said this is exactly what to do. Yeah. I think it looks... Okay, you know what? This looks pretty decent. I think I just need a little touch of a highlight right in the center. I think this could use just a little natural highlight right there.
Yeah, no, I have it right here. Hold on, I'm getting my ring light. No, she said you can't literally go anywhere without it, but I'm setting it up right now. No, I totally read the 25-page guide to 10 things that you need to know to look like Kylie. No, you just need to use the filter. You need to kind of look a little, what? And then just, yeah, that. I'm getting it right now.
I think that looks really natural. Yeah. Oh, she did? All right, well, I'll see you at the bridge in 20 minutes.
Crystal, thank you. Crystal Waters reporting there. Adding weight to the statement, monkey see, monkey do. Our final report tonight focuses on the fact that 18,000 Americans every year die from accidents at home. From minor burns to poisoning, from electric shocks to suffocation, injuries at home account for 21 million medical visits each year in the US. And account for a whopping $220 billion in medical costs. And of these injuries, none are more common than a fall, claiming nearly 6,000 lives, a similar amount to that of stimulant abuse. For a story like this, we need to pass to a reporter who has so much pride. He needn't worry about the fall. Let's pass to Les Whitlock.
Hello? It's Les Whitlock? Let's get the cord in. Alrighty. Hello, it's Les Whitlock from CNT News. Is anyone here? Okay. I'm doing my report now.
All right, let's get going. So I'm here in the kitchen where this injury occurred. Apparently it was a hyper dislocation of a 50-year-old man's leg as he stepped down a treacherous area to reach for a can of maybe beans, baked beans, could have been black beans, green beans. We don't know what exactly he was going after, because before it even happened and he could get to the pantry safely, he had fallen and crumpled into a hump. So let me show you where this happened, this tragic accident, and how it occurred. Thank you.
I'm gonna put the microphone down because it doesn't really work, so we don't need it. Anyways, here's the pantry, okay? So you can see it's too far for the hand to reach. And then here's the treacherous steps. So apparently what happened is there's no railings here, as you can see. The old man, who was in his 50s, stepped down using one foot after the other onto the first step. This step, he slipped, landing here and then falling backwards here into this little cubby area next to the dog thing. He landed here in this area, his knee buckled like so, fell. He tried to reach the pantry here and he slipped and fell and landed there. And that's pretty much how this is how a common household injury, show you again. You step down, this foot, and then this foot, you miss, you buckle, and then you can fall down in here. So that's what happened, and he never made it to the pantry. He lay there for at least 3 minutes until his wife came and yelled at him to get up.
Hey guys, I'm back. This is the wrap up. It's Les Whitlock here in Silver Spring, Maryland, covering a common but seems to be occurring much more often household injury around a common pantry. Les Whitlock reporting from CNT News, Washington, D.C. correspondent with a Monster High microphone that doesn't work, but it used to. Thanks.
Les, thank you. A man more accustomed to having the ladies fall at his feet. Les Whitlock reporting there. And that is about all we have time for this week. A huge thank you to you, the viewer at home. A huge thank you to my deep throat of reporters across the planet. The world is full of people taking cues from others. So why not be different? Grow a set of balls and get out your winter shorts. Don't have nightmares, and we'll see you next Tuesday.
I'm a little red in the face right now because I did just finish Googling hot Scottish men in kilts. Purely research. Wes Litlock.